from American Public Media.
I hear that old piano from down the avenue. I smell the palm trees and look around for you. Oh, my sweet, sweet, sweet someone, coming through that door. It's Saturday and the band is playing. Honey, could we ask for more? Whoa, whoa. Coming to you live from the Hollywood Bowl in Hollywood, California. It's a Prairie Home Companion, presented by American Public Media and produced by Prairie Home Productions. Well, our music director, the valiant Richard Dworsky, here at the piano, and our fine band sitting all around him. Mr. Larry Cohut back there in the bass, and Bernie Dressel playing the drums. Richard Crean on the mandolin and the fiddle. Chris Siebold playing guitar tonight. Our radio acting company with us, Sue Scott, Tim Russell, and our sound effects man, Mr. Fred Newman. Tonight's show is brought to you by Viking River Cruises, exploring the world in comfort, offering European cruises on Viking longships. More at brc.com/radio. And by Lumosity, Lumosity brain training with over 50 challenging games from scientists working with over 50 challenging games with university researchers to train 50 challenging games and push cognitive research forward with university researchers. Learn more at lumosity.com. We have a good show for you tonight. This is my big show, and my guests tonight are five young women who I never believed would come along, but they did, and it's wonderful how over the years they have reached out to our audience.
Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
And I sang duets with these wonderful women here.
Sing duets, harmony, harmony, harmony.
Let me tell you, good times never seemed so good as
so good, yeah. So good, so good.
And I was inclined to believe that they never would, and then I met them, Christine Di Gilonardo. Sarah Jarosz.
Many years ago in a kingdom by the sea.
Oh, Heather Massey is with us tonight.
And no sunshine when he's gone.
Aoife O'Donovan is here.
Dig a hole in the meadow. Dig a hole in the cold, cold ground.
Sarah Watkins.
Listen to the river sing sweet songs to rock my soul.
All right. We've got a show. It's a show of duets. So good to be here in Hollywood, especially if you grew up evangelical, as I did in Minnesota. It just makes it all the more meaningful, don't you know? In our home, Hollywood was a name that was used, as some people now use the term Wall Street or the Kremlin. It signified evil in our home. So, a sanctified brethren boy in Hollywood, you're just more watchful, that's all. And what you see is people walking dogs down the street there, all kinds of dogs, big dogs, some of them. And some of the people you see are producers. You can
Danny, Bobby, oh, how about lunch? Fabulous, I'm free in September. How about October?
And some people are actors as well.
Oh, hey, bro. Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. Oh, you know, you look so fabulous. And the skin tone looks so realistic.
Some people are grips and stage hands.
What's up?
And so they all
look terrific. Some people carry hair dryers with them, actually, out on the street here. Carry hairspray. Some of them have inflatable torsos and delts and pecs under their T-shirts. So if you hug them too closely, they deflate. And the people who don't look terrific, the people who look exhausted and sweaty, those are us. They're the tourists, and they're waiting for the bus tour to come.
Now, James Franco, he Skyped his mother.
Take
from
you
this
around to look at homes where stars used to live. There are Lamborghinis and Ferraris parked on the streets of Hollywood, and they all have alarms on them. So if you reach out to touch them,
whoop, whoop. Thank you for not touching my car.
There are palm trees, of course, in Hollywood. A great many of them, and their swimming pools. And carpools as well. And
hey, get in the carpool lane!
You go out of the houses and people are swimming and they're underwater in the swimming pools and they're singing underwater. It improves breath control somehow. It's a town where at any given moment the unemployment rate is about 65%. And that's why everybody is so glad to see anybody else.
Wow, you look so great.
So excited.
Oh, so do you. Oh, my God.
And that's why everybody's working out. They're working out all the time. They're working with weights, and they're on ellipticals, and they're Stairmasters. Many people hire a Rottweiler as a personal trainer. Keep them going. A person in Hollywood who does not work out daily is like an atheist in Waco, Texas. It's just you just don't get asked out. You people would rather not even see you. Everyone here has a talent. Everybody has a talent, and everybody is unique, of course. The security guy here at the bowl can play a tune on his screening wand. It's good for, you know, a minute or so. Your waiter who waits on you here at the bowl can play a squeeze bottle of ketchup. That's they call the wind Mariah. I'm not sure you recognize the tune, but that's what that is. Somebody's pet monkey we saw the other day can sing opera. The gardener can do songs on his chainsaw. It sounds like smoke gets in your eyes, but I'm not sure. We were staying at the Hollywood Sleepmore Motel on Sunset, where the night manager plays La Bamba on a hotel key card, which is interesting. He had a 14-month-old child who could sing.
I am you as you are, he as you are, me and we are all together. See how they went like this.
And his brother-in-law Mike is very talented in a way. He can gargle. He can gargle the theme from Mondo Cano. And we actually met a guy from Minnesota who made his home here. He brought his duck call, and he can play The Girl from Ipanema. Very good. We left that motel to stay at the Honeymoon Acres out in Malibu, and we could hear whales off the coast. They were auditioning. It's just a whole city of performers. I'm from Minnesota. It's a state of writers. Very, very different. And that's why we don't say that much. We're watching. We're always watching. We're gathering material. And that's why I'm here. You came here to see the show, and I came here to see you. And I'm watching you very closely. And I have a monologue later in the show, and you may well be in it. One never knows. Oh, sing a duet with me.
I love
beautiful you. Sarah Watkins, come.
And so I beg you, let it be me. Don't take this heaven from one. If you must cling to someone now and forever, let it be me. Each time we meet, love, I find complete love. Without your sweet love, what would life be? So never leave me lonely. Tell me you love me only, and that you'll always let it be me.
young woman with a child, living all alone on a hot night in summer with the television on. Good night, mama, says the child from a crib by the TV. And the woman washes two plates and cups till they're way past clean.
And the blue flash of the TV screen, he lightly inside and out. Oh, it gets lonely in a small town when midnight rolls around. An old woman at her soul by a rusty oil stove. The snow has covered everything. The years have covered love. Oh, they buried him 2 years ago in 6 feet of black dirt. She lives in just one room now. She's still mending his shirts. And the white flash of the man. In a small town when midnight rolls around.
By Mr. Greg Brown. Here's a bit of song that Iris DeMent wrote. We've sung this before, Aoife O'Donnell.
Yes, we have.
Isn't it a gorgeous, gorgeous thing? Who sings what? I forget.
You mean who's about to sing what in this next song?
I don't know. Melody from harmony.
I think we decided a duet the whole way through with me on melody.
You on melody.
Is that okay?
Hey, sure, of course. Of course. Harmony is my favorite place. I grew up among Lutherans, you know that. So we are all altos, all of us. All right.
Comes around, no one else will be there, so I won't have to worry about what I'm supposed to say. I alone will know that I climbed that great big mountain, and that's all that will matter when my morning comes around.
When my morning comes around, I will look back on this valley, at these sidewalks and alleys where I lingered for so long. And this place where I now live, it'll burn to ash and cinder, like some ghost I won't remember when my morning comes around.
Oh, Christine DiGiulinardo, thank you for coming all the way across country for this show.
I love this show.
He will not always say what you would have him say, but now and then he'll say something wonderful. The thoughtless things he'll do will hurt and worry you, and all at once he'll do something wonderful. He has a thousand dreams that won't come true. You know
this first part of our show brought to you, as always, by Powder Milk Biscuits in the big blue box with a picture of the biscuit on the cover. Heavens, they're tasty and expeditious. Give shy persons the strength to get up and do what needs to be done. Heavens, they're tasty. Powder Milk Biscuits. Thank you. Has your family tried them powder mill? Has your family tried them powder mill? Well, if your family's tried them all, you know you're satisfied, and they're the real hot item powder mill. Whoa, 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 whoa. I shall come to you from the Hollywood Bowl with all these wonderful women to sing duets with.
The Lives of the Cowboys, brought to you by Big Butte Jeans, the full-figure jeans with room in the seat, and by Jim's Used Shoes. If you like pre-faded jeans, you'll love used shoes. And now, today's exciting Western adventure.
Yep, come on, Jim. Yeah, ooh, yeah. Well, here we are, back in Yellow Gulch.
Yes, sir.
Looks about the same as ever, Dusty, unfortunately.
Yeah. Hey, you used to have a radio show here, as I recall.
In this very town, yes, I did.
Yep.
Indeed, I did. Bunkhouse Buddies, it was called, Dusty. Boy, I miss that show. You remember that theme song, huh?
Yeah, I'm afraid I do.
Oh, I'm sad here on the prairie, going through life all alone. I can't wait until I am buried underneath a big white stone.
Right.
I've lost the one that I loved, 'cause I had intimacy issues. Now the shoes beneath her bed are not mine, but his shoes. So bury me beneath the snowbanks with the other lonely men. Resurrection, I say no thanks. Why go through it all again? Ooh, boy, I sure wish I had that show. Why did it ever end? I forget.
Well, it ended because you never smiled.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. You know, people can tell.
It was radio. I mean, what's the difference?
All the same, your voice was depressing, too.
Oh, yeah.
So you had to have a woman singing with you, lest your listeners go eat a cup of toilet bowl cleanser.
Oh, yeah?
Yep. And after a couple of weeks of singing with you, the women were done with it, and that is what happened, partner.
Boy, I remember. He was so right. I remembered those women so well. I loved them all. One by one, they handed in their resignation. Like Serotonin, we sounded so good together, I thought. She was a tall girl. She wore this bright orange dress that just thrilled me to pieces. She and I had a big hit together.
All day I faced the barren waste, a hoping for a furlough and a glass of Merlot. Me and my horse rode across the range, feeling hot and wobbly. Looking for some shobbly. We'll keep a moving, Dan, till we find a pop stand that will sell us a can from his big wooden tank of Sauvignon Blanc. Dan, can you see that winery where they bottle Burgundy, that beautiful Côte de Nuit?
Oh, I just always felt so close to Serotonin. Until one day, she brought it up.
I've got something I've got to say to you, Lefty.
Well, what's that, darling?
Now, don't take this personally or anything, but I'm leaving you.
What?
I got an offer to sing with the Waylon Jennies.
Oh, you're leaving me?
I'm sorry.
Why?
Yes. They're Canadian, Lefty, so they're really, really nice people.
Hmm.
And none of them chew tobacco.
No, I can give up the tobacco. Don't worry about it.
Well, you know what? They pay me.
Oh. That, huh?
Yes, that.
All right. There was a lovely singer named Rhoda Dendron. She was from up in Boston, very good social skills. She had a good ear and also a very lovely neck, and her hair was bouncy and natural and just the way I like it. We had a hit together.
You who are on a horse,
must ride, of course, across the prairie with guys with shifty eyes. You hope your daughters do not marry. Teach your children they should try to stay up on the saddle and not to drink the water that is downstream from the cattle. Tell them always wear a grin and don't spit into the wind. Try to stay away from gin and stick with whiskey.
Hey, Lefty.
Hello to you.
Well, I like singing with you and everything, but when we go out and do our personal appearances and take a bow just as the audience is giving us a standing ovation.
Yeah, what?
Would you mind not holding my hand?
You don't want to hold hands?
Well, it sends the wrong message.
Okay, all right, whatever.
I mean, people might think we're an item. They might think we're an item, and it doesn't matter because I'm going off with a new group called Brooklyn Rider.
What?
It's a cowboy quartet in Brooklyn.
Okay. Good luck. Sorry about that.
I mean, it's actually a pretty big step up for me.
Mm.
They're paying me money.
Oh, really? Okay, good. Well, I'm going to miss you.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Barbara Seville was my next partner, and she was great. She wore a red gardenia in her hair, and she played castanets, and boy, she just seemed to be what the doctor ordered, you know?
I want to be a cowboy sweetheart. I want to learn to rope and ride. I want to ride through the plains and the desert, out west of the Great Divide.
I'm a cowboy who needs a sweetheart. I will teach you to ride and rope.
I want to be a cowboy sweetheart, but one who uses shampoo and soap.
I want to be your cowboy sweetheart and live a life that's free.
Or is it to get in on my health care? You want to move in with me?
If you would be my duet partner, I would be overjoyed.
I want to sing duets with the cowboy, but not one who's unemployed. Singing in close harmony, sponsored by laxative makers and the AARP. I will tell tall tales of the cowboys, and we will sing sweet duets, and you will put a fresh gardenia in your hair and play your castanets.
Is what I would call wonderful castanets right there, darling. I just love to hear you do that. Watch
well,
you do it too.
What? I've got to tell you, Lefty.
What?
I'm putting out a solo album.
No.
I'm going out on my own.
Oh, gosh. I could be your backup singer.
How far back?
Oh.
Look, you can't stand beside me.
No?
You'd have to be in the back and play bass.
I draw the line at that plan base, ma'am. I just can't do it. Nice knowing you, Barbara. All right, good luck. Good luck with your music.
Same.
Yeah. The Bunkhouse Buddies show was sponsored by Campfire Coffee, and I recorded the jingle with a lovely young woman named Angioplasty. She was Irish girl.
Out here on the range, why not make your coffee gourmet? Where guys like Wyatt Earp ask for hazelnut syrup in the grande-sized mocha latte. Oh, you'll flip your lid just like Billy the Kid from Cheyenne to Santa Fe. On the Oregon Trail, it is served by the pail. Try Campfire Coffee today.
Boy, you sound great on that.
Thanks.
Just wonderful.
Thanks.
Yeah, maybe you'd like to join the show as my duet partner.
I mean, but I don't sing cowboy songs.
You don't? No?
Well, no, I'm from New York. Broadway. My idea of cowboy songs is... Oklahoma, where the wind comes sweeping down the plain, and the waving wheat can sure smell sweet when the wind comes right behind the rain. Oklahoma, every night my honey lamb and I sit alone and talk and watch the hawk making lazy circles in the sky. Well, excuse me.
What?
Well, I don't do this as a duet.
Not the honey lamb and I part?
No, especially not that part.
All right, I'm sorry. Anything you'd like to sing with me? Or?
Well, do you mind if I ask a personal question?
Oh, dear.
Do you brush?
My teeth? Yes,
yeah.
I brush with baking soda.
Well, ever think of using toothpaste? Like the kind that's nice and minty?
I don't know. I guess I could think about it, but I...
Well, let me know when you decide.
Oh, boy. Oh, I thought of all of them. Dusty and I headed into the saloon.
Yep, here we are at the Last Chance Saloon, partner. Time for you to drown your regrets in a glass of rotgut whiskey.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Hey, piano player.
Yeah?
Hey.
You got a request?
I've got a request. Could you play something other than Camptown Races, please?
Camptown Races? I thought I was playing Mood Indigo. Dang it.
No, it's not. It's Camptown Races. Just play something else, okay?
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so what can I get you boys?
Well, thank you, ma'am. A couple of glasses of rotgut whiskey there, Myrtle.
All right, you want the single rot or the blend?
Yeah, blended. No ice in mine.
All righty, how about you?
I would have ice.
All
thank
righty,
you.
Come right up.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's...
Listen up here, poetry man.
What you up to, Messer?
There ain't room for two poets in this here town.
Huh?
Used to be two, and now he's buried up there on Boot Hill.
Well, I hope you gave him a good funeral, that's all.
It was a lovely funeral. Almost made me cry, and I was the one who shot him.
No? Why'd you do that, Big Messer?
He plagiarized from me. He stole the word alas from me.
I see, huh?
And now you stole the line, bury me out in the lone prairie, for me. So say your prayers, plagiarizer. You are soon to meet your editor.
Not yet, Messer.
What? Who are you?
I'm the one holding this Remington shotgun in the small of your back, and that's why you're gonna set that pea shoot of yours down on the bar nice and slow. Very nice and slow. Otherwise, I'm gonna cut you a new buttonhole in this nice silk shirt of yours. Good. Just like that, and now push it away nice and slow.
Who are you, lady?
I'm the editor of Poetry Magazine.
You! You're the one who's been sending me all them rejection letters!
And there's a lot more where those came from.
I owe you a big debt of gratitude there.
Oh, yes, you
lady.
Do.
Yeah.
Yes, you do.
Saved my life. How about I buy you a glass of whiskey here?
You owe me a bigger debt than that, mister.
Okay. What would you like?
Well, it's been my dream ever since I was a small child to sing duets with a cowboy on the radio.
Oh, really?
All through my life, all through my years as an editor, it was the only thing that I ever wanted to do. And
really?
Wear, you know, a big white hat and some shiny
sure.
boots and stand next to a big handsome man and sing about life on the trail.
Well, happen to be looking for just such a person right now.
I thought so. See them tumbling down, pledging their love to the ground. Lonely but free, I'll be found, drifting along with the tumbling tumbleweeds. Cares of the past are behind. Nowhere to go, but I'll find just where the trail will wind. Drifting along with the tumbling tumbleweeds. I know when night has gone that a new world born at dawn.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for that. We'll be in touch. We'll let you know.
You don't want to hear more?
No, that we heard it. That's good. That's
all right,
fine.
You'll let me know then.
I will. Yes, we'll let you know very quickly. Believe me. Right away.
Well, I guess I'm just not attractive to young women anymore.
Well, now, I guess that depends on what you mean by young.
Ma'am?
See, I'm young enough to be interested and yet old enough to know what's what.
Uh-huh.
Say, how about we open up a big bottle of red wine and have at it until our standards are reduced to a reasonable level? Huh? What do you say, huh?
Yeah, come well, on.
There you go.
I don't know.
What?
I think you're lovely and you're dark and deep, but we have promises to keep and mouths to go before we sleep. Ain't
took
that
the
right?
words out of my mouth there, Dusty.
Well, now where is it that you're all going to?
Well, ma'am, we don't know, but we'll recognize it when we get there.
That's
wait
right.
a minute. You're heading out there without a plan?
Yep.
No destination in mind?
We're cowboys. That's how we operate. Let's go, Dusty.
Come on.
The Lives of the Cowboys, brought to you by Big Butte Jeans, the full-figure jeans with room in the seat, and by Jim's Used Shoes.
Sarah Watkins, it's dangerous to sing flat. Your voice could get stuck. It's like crossing your eyes. You've been warned not to do it. Let me hear you sing a note. Oh, come on. What you going to do here with Aoife O'Donovan?
This is a Nick Drake tune. It's called Which Will.
Which will you go for? Which will you love? Which will you choose from the stars above? Which will you answer? Which will you call? Which will you take for your one and all? Tell me now, which will you love the best? Which do you dance for? Which makes you shine? Which will you choose now? If you won't choose mine, which will you hope for? Which can
Hey, the master Ethel Donovan, Cheryl Watkins there playing. I want to sing another duet. I want to sing a duet with you, Christine DiGiulinardo. There's a song called Friendship. I believe in that. That was the whole reason for starting a radio show, was to get to meet people. If you had no social skills whatsoever, was to get to meet people, and people would walk up to you and they'd say, I heard you on the radio. And this was the beginning of a conversation that would lead in all sorts of interesting directions. Got to meet you.
That's right.
On the radio, that's right. Brooklyn girl. Woo-hoo. Brooklyn girl. Friendship.
If they kick you off the air, I will care.
Oh, thank you.
If you're fined for obscenity, you can count on me. If they catch you on plagiarism, I'll visit you in prison.
It's friendship, friendship. What a lovely friendship. When other friendships have bit the dust, ours will be robust.
If your computer should crash and burn, I'll show concern.
If your iPhone is out of order, I'll lend you a quarter.
If trolls throw you in flames, I'll take their names.
If your car is repossessed, I will protest.
If you're kicked out of the house, you can have my couch.
If garbage is burned in your yard, I'll send you a card.
It's friendship, friendship. What a lovely friendship. When other friendships have run out of gas, ours will still kick ass.
If your novel is panned by the Times, I'll ring their chimes. If you don't get a Pulitzer Prize, I'll roll my eyes.
If your show gets booed, I'll bring you food. If the critics trash your performance, I'll send reinforcements.
It's friendship, friendship. What a lovely friendship. When other friendships have fallen off, we'll be Mazel Tov.
When you do your last show, I'll try to go.
That would sure be nice. I'll let you in for half price.
If we don't see duet, I won't be upset.
If you don't bring me a bouquet, well, that's okay.
If you're quitting 'cause you're ill, I'll help you write out your will.
If you get lost at the bowl, I'll send a patrol.
It's friendship, friendship. What a lovely friendship. When other friendships are all pooped, ours will have.
If you get arterial sclerosis, I'll send roses.
If you need a new kidney, I'll talk to Uncle Sydney.
When you're in the memory unit, I'll still be doing it.
When you are old and gray, I'll send a bouquet.
If your plane crashes, I'll scatter your ashes.
And if you do, they'll blow on you.
Friendship, friendship. What a lovely friendship. When other friendships are in the pits, we'll be at the Ritz. As other friendships go off and die, ours is flying high.
King, come in here with another message from our sponsor, the Ketchup Advisory Board.
These are the good years for Barb and me. Ever since we decided that life is too short to spend it in traffic, and we left in L.A. and moved to St. Paul, Minnesota.
Oh, Jim, can we talk? Well, we've been here 15 years, and it still just doesn't feel right.
What is it, Barb? You don't like winter?
Well, I don't mind winter. It's the apologizing. People brush up against you in the grocery store, and they say, oh, I'm sorry. People at the dinner table who say, I'm sorry, could you pass the butter? Mm. People in the crosswalk, and you stop for them, and they wave for you to go ahead, and oh, you wave for them to go ahead, and time passes, and this after you, Alphonse routine goes on for too long.
It's just politeness, Barb.
No, it's creepy. I mean, people who come to your house and just sit there and look at you.
Well, they're shy.
Jim, when you're in company, you have a responsibility to carry on a conversation. Mm. You can't just sit there and look at your shoes.
I think it's a cultural thing.
It's rude is what it is. Mm. You ask them how they are, and they say, oh, not so bad then. How are you doing then?
Well, Barb, what's wrong with that?
Well, Jim, the question, how are you, is an invitation to say something. Mm. Tell a story, sing a song, do something. Don't just stand there.
So, you thinking about going back to L.A.?
Well, I was looking at the ads, and I saw a nice little house on San Pedro. Now, it used to be a garage, but now it's a studio apartment. Listen to this. 1,000 square feet, okay? $659,000. And I called up the seller, and darn it, they have an offer for $750,000. So guess what, Jim? I offered $800,000. But anyway, he didn't seem very excited.
You know, Barb.
What?
We came to Minnesota to simplify our lives. But maybe we forgot something.
Oh?
A condiment with natural mellowing agents. One that makes you feel more satisfied with where you are.
Okay, real good then.
That sound okay?
Yeah, not so bad.
These are the good years in the summer sun. 4th of July weekend, independence has been won. Life is flowing like ketchup on a bun.
Ketchup for the good times.
Ketchup. Catch up.
Three good friends of mine formed a wonderful trio. They formed this beautiful trio called I'm With Her. They came up with that name before Hillary did, and so I hope they stay with it on into and past her administration. I'm With Her. So it's good to have them here, Sarah Girouse and Aoife O'Donovan down there in the end, and Sarah Watkins. I'm With Her.
I look to see the wildflowers blooming and wonder why they seem so strange. The springtime rise, the brown hills over, and a young bird sings in a silver rain. I think of you as the night rolls by. You're on my mind the whole day. Far away in a lonesome city, all the time you're gone, I think of you. And when my world has turned to sunlight, and the dust clouds summer sky, I number all the climbing roses, watch to see the milkweed fly. I think of you as the night rolls by. You're on my mind the whole day through. Far away in Lonesome City, all the time you're gone, I think of you. Wind moaning like an angel's voice from a far off shore, my days slip by like light snow falling or dry brown leaves blown by my door. I think of you as the night rolls by. You're on my mind the whole day through. Far away in a lonesome city, all the time you're gone, I think of you as the night rolls by. You're time you're gone, I think of you.
Sarah Jarosz, Ethel Donovan, Sarah Watkins. This is a song that we've never, ever sung on the show before, so we just have to make up for lost time. And this requires you out there to sing along with us. I know you don't want to, but you will want to as soon as you get into it. It's a very, very beautiful chorus, and it's sung with great enthusiasm. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. If you're Unitarian and you can't sing Zion, you could sing "We're marching together, closely together." We're marching upward together to the beautiful city of love. City of love. You can sing that, can't you? All right. We're marching to Zion. The chorus. What's my key here? What's the chorus? Go something. Mm-hmm. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
More basses, more tenors.
We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city. Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and us around the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching sorrows of the mind be banished from the place. Religion never was designed. Religion never was designed to make our pleasures less. To make our pleasures less. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but favorites of the heavenly King, but favorites of the heavenly King, may speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The God that rules on high and thunders when he pleases, who rides upon the stormy sky, who rides upon the stormy sky, and manages the seas, and manages the seas. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. There we shall see his face and never, never sin. They're from the rivers of his grace. They're from the rivers of his grace. Drink endless pleasures in. Drink endless pleasures in. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. One more chorus. We're marching to Zion,
beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
Gorgeous. We're going to pause and take a brief intermission, and then we'll be back with the second half of our show. You're listening to A Prairie Home Companion with all these fine women singers in our fine band and acting company with us for the second half of the show. The news from Lake Wobegon as well. You're listening to A Prairie Home Companion coming to you live from the Hollywood Bowl in Hollywood, California. Prairie Home Companion is made possible by Viking River Cruises. Sailing through the heart of cities in Europe, Russia, and Asia, Viking River Cruises, exploring the world in comfort. Learn more at vrc.com. If you have free time, and who does, but maybe you do, you could go to our website at prairiehome.org. You can listen to old shows there. Find a brand new 3-CD set of Lake Wobegon stories called The Road Home. It's all there at prairiehome.org. A Prairie Home Companion is produced by Prairie Home Productions and distributed by American Public Media. Thank you. Welcome back to the second half of our broadcast, A Prairie Home Companion, coming to you on this lovely, lovely summer evening from the Hollywood Bowl, Hollywood, California. We have a wonderful crowd here at the Hollywood Bowl. I want to say Bob and Lisa Peck want to say hello to their kids, Martin in Sacramento, and Garrett and family in Clearwater, Florida, where he's serving in the Coast Guard. Annette says, hello to Mom. Get better soon after you fall off the ladder. Next time, hire the kid next door to pick the lemons. David and Betsy say hello to Guy and Peggy in Berea, Kentucky. We miss the fireflies and the bluegrass, but the West Coast is beautiful, and the earthquakes are fairly infrequent. Alicia Estrada is here. Says, honey, thank you for the ticket. I'm really enjoying the show. Now please stop texting me. Sheila's here from Oakland. She says, to Hillary, please win this election. Hello. Greg sends love to his lovely wife, Jan, who for 28 years has allowed me to ride a motorcycle. You still rev my motor, baby. Alan and Sharon love each other very much, 36 plus years, and much more happiness to come. Ralph sends much love to mother-in-law, Ida Einbinder, celebrating her 94th birthday. If I had known you were part of the deal, I would have married your daughter much sooner. Congratulations to Michael Titterton, who is retiring this week, and a shout out to the busload of listeners from KCBX in San Luis Obispo who are here. Well, that was a big bus, wasn't it? Sally says hello to Claire Ford in the hot, hot gardens of Palm Beach. Hello to Mom and Dad and girls up in Clear Lake. Don't worry, the dogs are still alive, says John Jay. To Hilda, wishing you could be here with us, and sorry about your dislocated shoulder. Love from your favorite grandson. Andrew, we're engaged now. Maybe now my brother will recognize you. Happy retirement to Barb, and Greg in Oregon. Love from Christine, and welcome to our 13-year-old daughter Ella back from Catalina Sea Camp today. Love from your mom and dad. Hello to my mom, Jenny Lee, who is a sweet, sweet woman. And happy anniversary, Karen and Kevin and Ralph and Debbie. Jean and Jim and Jeannie and Doug and Jack and Jan and Roz and Gil and Eddie and Susie been married 70 years. Happy birthday to Janet Morris, Nina Fresco, Standalin, Dina Duckworth, and Aaron Elliott, Scott Paquette, and Jean Campbell, and Dorothy, who is 100 years old. We don't take phone calls on A Prairie Home Companion. It's not a call-in show, but this call comes from the White House, so we're going to make an exception. Mr. President, so good to hear from you. How are you doing?
It is good to talk to you, Garrison. How are you doing out in L.A.?
Oh, we're doing just fine. Listen, we are going to miss you an awful lot. You've got about 6 months left. I've been thinking a lot about you recently. They're just, I don't know how to put this in ways that are not going to embarrass you, but you are the coolest president of my lifetime. And I go back to Harry Truman, so I've seen a wide swath of presidents. And you are the coolest. And when I say cool, I mean dignity, I mean wit, I mean humor, I mean...
You're right, you're making me blush. That's it.
You've never had an awkward moment ever in all these years, and I just, I take my hat off to you and the First Lady and your family. You just make us proud, and so there you are.
You are very kind, Garrison.
So, what's going to happen to you now? You've got a book that you have to write, and it's going to be...
Yeah, I'll probably write a book.
Are you going to be able to drive a car after you're out of the White House?
I'm going to be negotiating with the Secret Service around that. I don't have any desire to drive a car in traffic.
Yeah.
But if you got a stretch of open road, since you're out in California, just as an example, driving up the Pacific Coast Highway for a stretch, that wouldn't be bad. I think it'd make me feel better.
There are parts of western Minnesota and North Dakota where you could drive a car and just have a wonderful time. I'm not sure Washington, D.C. is the best place for an ex-president to settle. I know you're doing it because you have a daughter still in school, and that's good, but you really need to get away from there.
I think that's true. But as Michelle points out, her and the girls have put up with a lot, and I can put up with this for a couple of years. But there is an element of staying in Washington. You're sort of like the high school football star who kept on sticking around and still comes by campus, and people are a little embarrassed about it. I think that's how it will feel to be the ex-president and still be lurking around here. So I don't suspect it'll be my permanent residence.
You are a writer. You know that deep down. That's who you are.
That is something I'm looking forward to. You know, I do believe that telling stories is still the thing that sets us apart from the rest of God's creation. And that is part of the reason why I think we've all been so incredibly lucky over these last 42 years to have you and the rest of the crew at a Prairie Home Companion. And now I'm going to make you blush. You know, one of the reasons I miss driving is because you kept me company for a lot of years. When I was slogging back and forth in the state Senate between Chicago and Springfield, or I was campaigning in Iowa and places, you know, hearing about what was going on in Minnesota, and hearing about the latest episodes of Dusty and Lefty and Guy Noir, it made me feel better, and it made me feel more human. And I think a lot of people feel that way. So we've been lucky to have you, and you are going to be missed. And I just wanted to make sure that I added my voice in what I'm sure will be a lot of embarrassing stuff coming your way, because like many Minnesotans, I don't think you like taking compliments.
Well, thank you for taking the time, and good luck with the book. You have a terrific editor right there at home, and so I wish you well with that. You have a great story to tell, and we're all looking forward to it.
I appreciate it.
Enjoy your time. Godspeed to you. Bye-bye. This is a song I wrote so many years ago. I guess you could call it nostalgic, but I don't really know what nostalgia is when you've lived a long time. It simply is the truth that some things are clearer than other things, and one thing that's very clear for me is the memory of my Uncle Jim's farm, where he lived with my grandmother, and where I used to be sent for some reason for weeks at a time through the summertime. That plane would remind me of his tractor if he had had a tractor, which he did not. He farmed with a pair of horses. I love that farm, and I think back on it, and I think one reason I loved it so much was that it was a place where you could watch a man at work and see everything that he did. You could see him raking hay, you could see him milking cows, you could see him cultivating, you could see him driving that team of horses. I loved those graceful horses. This is a song about two Belgian workhorses, Brownie and Pete. Oh, the harness jingle on Brownie and Pete, two big Belgians and their dancing feet, riding on a hay rack down a muddy lane. I was 7 years old, but I got to hold the reins. Uncle Jim up beside me, standing up on the rack, hang on to the crossbar, boy, push the branches back. One last ride, last summer day, one time around, then it's back to town to the second grade.
Oh, the harness jingle when they got to run, and the load was easy when the work was done. Those big feet dancing, their big backs shown,
And they tossed their heads like thoroughbreds when we headed home. Oh, the hay rack bouncing, hang on to the bar. Haul back on the range now, turn them in at the yard. Take off that harness, lead them in at the door. Wipe off their coats, get a bucket of oats and a bag of corn, boys. Last day of summer, school begins. Goodbye to Grandma. Uncle Jim, goodbye Brownie,
goodbye Pete.
Hop in the car, get home after dark and go to sleep. Oh, I like that song. Head on the pillow, have a sweet, sweet dream. Riding on a hayrack, coming home with a team. Handsome horses run side by side. Uncle Jim says, oh, we're going on one last ride. Oh, the harness jingled on Brownie and Pete.
Two big Belgians on the dancing feet.
Riding on a hayrack down a muddy lane.
I was 7 years old, but I got to hold the reins.
I was 7 years old, but I got to hold the reins.
You got to bring up this fine piano player here. This man has been the music director of our show. Hardest working man ever on any radio show. And a terrific piano player. Here's a Dooney Rod himself, little stride piece, Mr. Richard Dworsky. Thank you, Mr. Dworsky. What a beautiful piano. Brother Master, so good to have you with us on this You're going to sing me a sad song now and make me cry? Are you trying to make me cry, or what's going on here?
You're going to make us cry,
what?
Harrison.
I wouldn't know how.
We're going to miss you.
What?
We're going to miss you.
I'm going to miss President Obama, is who I'm going to miss. I hope I don't miss him too absolutely, if you know what I mean. Anyway, sing me a song. I'll just sit here and listen to it.
All right.
All right.
This is for you.
Every time we say goodbye, I cry a little. Every time we say goodbye, I wonder why a little. Why the gods above me, so little of me, they allow you to go.
Heather Massey. Well, it's been a quiet week in Lake Wobegon, Minnesota, my hometown, out on the edge of the prairie. It was a beautiful, beautiful summer day, one of those perfect summer days that we think are rare, and actually they are not. And anyway, you know, how many do we deserve? I mean, how many do we expect? As our due, how many are we entitled to? It's a gift, you know. Just say thank you, and maybe tomorrow will be as good. You never know. I was a reader back when I lived in Lake Wobegon, and so sunny days were not necessarily what I was looking for. Sunny days meant that you had to go out and pick potatoes, and that was the hardest work that there possibly was. You sat on the front porch, though, when it rained, and you felt so happy, and you sat there, and the water was sluicing down out of the rain spouts and dripping off the eaves, and you sat there with your book, which was about a tramp steamer that was bound for Malay, and it was a, a crew of nefarious seamen, some of which seemed criminal and the rest seemed incompetent. And they were all there, and it was the first mate, John Phillips, who was responsible for bringing this load of tin roofing and hemp and truck transmissions all the way across the Pacific Ocean, because Captain McGuire was already on his third martini. And so there he was on the bridge. That was my idea of a good time, was reading a novel about other people I did not know who were in desperate straits. And sunshine, I don't know. It just meant that you had to go work on a truck farm, and then in the evening you had to go out and play softball, and you were stuck out in right field, and you spent these long, tedious innings out there, you know, all by yourself. And then suddenly this moment of terror when this high fly ball is up, and it always were right in the sun, and you're looking directly into the sun, and people are yelling at you, back, 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 and the base runners are going, and you can't see it at all. No. When you've lived in one place for so long, you see, you go back, and you are in a museum there. Everywhere you go, there are the dead. They're all around. The living are running around, you know, doing whatever the living need to do, but they're not aware of the dead, but I am. I walk there down Main Street, and there's the Mercantile and the owner Clifford, who used to fix up those window displays and the women in the ancient sport clothes in the front windows, and Clifford bending over them and adjusting their garments, although you did sense that he was not that interested in women and his own life. But he had this amazing hairdo in which he made his few remaining strands of yellowish hair, he made them into a dome which defied the force of gravity. You could see through it. It was a work of art, and at certain hours of the day you could see the whole spectrum of light in this dome of hair. It's like he carried a rainbow under this dome. It was so disappointing when Clifford died to see him in his coffin. He looked deflated. He didn't look like that person at all. He'd been an angelic being, and now he was dead, he was not. He was very, very mortal as a dead person. Back behind the Mercantile is the beach where my classmate Arlen, he went into the lake on his snow machine, which he had built himself. He was the first one to have one, and he was very proud of it. It was very loud. It was very fast, and there was ice on the lake, but it was December, and there wasn't enough ice on the lake. And all of us knew that if he hadn't seen Barb walking down by the lake, he never would have gone for it. But he was crazy about her, and she waved to him, and that wave was his death sentence. She waved to him, and he wanted to impress her, and so he gunned the engine, and it was a very powerful engine. And so, because he was so in love, he went very fast, and he got 150 yards out on the ice, out beyond where anybody could have saved him, and he sank out there. He died for love. He died for Barb, and then she married his brother Arnie instead, who turned out to be a very good husband after she got through the first 10 years or so, which had been odd because he was Arlen's twin, after all, and it seemed to prolong the grieving process, you know, to be sleeping next to the person you were grieving for. It was an odd thing. And coming from Lake Wobegon, of course, she couldn't talk to anybody about it. There were no grief counselors back in the day. But eventually Arnie did age, and his hair got very thin, and he got glasses, and he had back problems, so he became cautious, which Arlen had never been. And when this happened, and he and he came into his own. She gradually came to love him, which does happen. I look at the Chatterbox Cafe, and other people see a menu on a blackboard, and I see where people used to sit who are no longer living. Father Emil sat back in that corner booth, which, of course, we called the confessional then, and he was an old priest, and he had enormous black eyebrows. He was the man who saw so many weeping young women who had become pregnant, and at each one of them, he yelled the same thing. He yelled, "If you didn't want to go to Chicago, why'd you get on the train?" he said. This was his idea of counseling. He retired from Our Lady of Perpetual Responsibility, and he went to live in Gettysburg because he was a Civil War buff, and he walked that battlefield every day. The weather was even passable, and he died there. He died on the battlefield of a heart attack. He died behind Confederate lines where Longstreet's Corps had made its attack on the 2nd of July, 1863. And the Confederates were heroically repulsed by the 1st Minnesota Volunteers at great loss of life. And so it must have been very odd for Father Emil to realize where he was dying, surrounded by men in gray, he being a Union man, but death finds us where it will, of course. Jack of Jack's Auto Repair used to sit in the booth next to Father Emil, and of course they ignored each other. They acted as if the other one did not exist. Jack lived in his summer cabin out on the lake, out north of the lake. He sold his house in town after his wife Loretta died. It was just too sad for him to be there any longer. She sang on the radio, which was how they met. She sang on a late night show called Hobbs House, which was hosted by Franklin Hobbs from his cabin on Lake Hammond. And Jack fell in love with her sight unseen, just from hearing her sing "It Had to Be You" on the radio. And then he was called up by the Army, and he was terrified of losing her. And so he married her over the telephone, having never seen her. He married her from Fort Leonard Wood and came back 2 years later, and there she was. She was brunette, she was not blonde, and she was a little heavier than he thought she was, but she was Loretta. She was this beautiful, beautiful singer. So they kept the lights dim there in the house, and now the two of them are in the cemetery together. She was buried and he was cremated, and she was such a tidy person that you just know that it bothers her to have those ashes in the coffin with her. It's just she's trying to get rid of them. Jack never cared for my radio show, and he told me every time he saw me. He was a jazz guy. He did not care for sentimental songs about home, although I did point out to him that half of the sentimental songs were songs about wanting to leave home. But anyway, he's there. Jack is in the graveyard. And Larry, who manages the graveyard, tells me that he is saving me a spot, which is next to Jack and Loretta, which is a thought, you know, to lie for 100 years or so next to a guy who didn't like your work. Kind of makes cremation seem attractive somehow. I am at that age now where people start to use the word legacy, although there is no such thing, and we all know that. Just radio has the permanence of a sandcastle. And even books that are printed on acid-free paper, they tend to migrate towards recycling rather quickly. I saw a book of mine on sale at a yard sale for 35 cents, and nobody was buying it. And that's the fate of a good many of us writers. I go down to the sub-basement of my neighborhood library and I see there the books by the great literary lions of my day, Fitzgerald and Hemingway and Faulkner and Flannery O'Connor, all the heroes of my youth, now lying there unread. I once sat on the downtown Broadway local in Manhattan, and I rode sitting 4 feet away from a young African-American woman who was reading a book of mine. She was 4 feet away from me, and she was not laughing or even smiling, but she kept turning the pages. It was very hard for me to read the expression on her face. She looked like she was in the investment business, heading down to Wall Street. I couldn't tell. We just rode facing each other from 96th Street all the way down to 14th, and then I just couldn't take it any longer. If she had snapped the book shut and tossed it aside, it just would have killed me. She was posterity, and I couldn't bear to see how I would rank with her. But a few weeks ago, this boy named David came around after the show, and he liked a limerick that I had done on the show. He liked it well enough that he had memorized it, which is not that hard with a limerick. He knew this limerick. A young fellow from Pocatello said, "Why is my urine bright yellow? Was it something I ate, or could it be Kate who I dated on Saturday?" Hello! He liked this limerick. He liked another one of mine. A young fellow answered an ad and was hired and said, "I'm so glad to be given the chance. I could pee in my pants," and we looked and we saw that he had. He liked it a lot. He said, "Why do you like to write limericks?" Well, I like to write them because I discovered them when I was about his age, maybe a little younger, the age of 12, and I first came across the forbidden limerick. There was an old man of Nantucket. And I laughed so hard that stuff came out of my nose. This involuntary, convulsive laughter. And the same thing when I read about "There Was an Old Man of Antietam." You can look it up on your own. Don't ask me to do the rest of them. I loved them so much. It was not what I set out to do. I intended to be a serious poet, to be a serious symbolist, suicidal poet, and to write dark, dark things. But instead, I was fascinated by the limerick. Hitler had just one ball. Goebbels had two, but they were small. Himmler had something similar. And Goering had no balls at all. I love this limerick. So I turned to it. I did not have the experience. I did not have the right childhood to write suicidal poetry. And so I did this show for which I wrote the occasional limerick. I used to do avant-garde dance with a blowtorch, blue paint, and no pants, which some people guessed was genius and the rest left quickly when given the chance. There is an old man of St. Paul put his desk in a toilet stall. It was quiet, conducive, and one had the use of the plumbing with no weight at all. The thing about writing limericks is that if you write a great, great limerick, people will remember it, but they will forget the name of the person who wrote it. And that's okay. the permanence of anonymity, the immortality of the anonymous. Long live the jokes, and who cares who thought them up? They are permanent. And if years from now you should see the young fellow from Pocatello in a collection of verse or written on a toilet stall, it'll be anonymous, even though I wrote it in a hotel room once in Pocatello, Idaho, but that's okay. His urine will still be bright yellow, and he'll still be saying, hello. And maybe some immature boy will laugh uncontrollably and stuff will come out his nose when he reads this limerick. And if that is the case, then we have come full circle, and what more can you hope for? That's the news from Lake Wobegon, where all the women are strong, all the men are good looking, and all the children are above average.
That you're missing. It ain't my voice, but all the sweet things that I say. I'm not your only honeybee. Who are you kidding? Sing your sad songs, do the rest. Let them believe they get your best. It's time that we both stop faking. It ain't love we're making. No, I don't wanna be your missus. Mister, you won't miss me. You just miss my kisses. Don't save my number, you won't ever find me calling. I was happy for a minute, be even better after you've left. You can keep your seasons and I will keep my sunshine. Keep your money and your time and I'll hold on to mine. It's time that we both stop faking. No offense, none taken. No, I don't wanna be your missus. Mister, you won't miss me. You just miss my kisses. You won't miss me. You just miss my kisses. Please don't make a scene. Pretend to cry. Just smile and say goodnight. And kiss me goodbye one last time. Stop faking. No one's heart is breaking. No, I don't wanna be your missus. Mister, you won't miss me. You just miss my kisses. You won't miss me. You just miss my kisses. You won't miss me. You just miss my kisses.
Sarah Watkins, Sarah Jarosz.
So, it's your last show, huh? Last show.
Yeah.
So how does it feel?
Well, it's the first last show I've ever done, so I don't know, you know, how's it supposed to feel? Huh?
Yeah, but how does it feel right now?
You're asking me how it feels? Come on, I'm from Minnesota, you know?
Oh, right.
Remember?
Yeah,
you may as well ask, you know, how does Tuesday feel? You know, how does parking your car feel?
Right? Well, how does it feel? How does it feel?
Feels like Tuesday, you know?
Oh,
I mean,
come on.
Well, what? We're Stoics. We're from Minnesota. We're brought up to repress our feelings.
That's
and we're
right. Of course.
Very good at it,
yeah,
so.
Yeah. But come on now. You're going to miss it, though.
What, miss parking my car? I don't
doing the show. You're going to miss doing the show.
Oh, come on, Tim. The radio was an accident. It was never my ambition. My ambition was the circus, you know, and that's what I'm going to be doing starting on Monday.
I had no idea that was an ambition.
There's never been a circus act before that had a chimpanzee, a chicken, and a chihuahua.
I'd like to see that.
That's the first one. Watch. Here we go. I believe there are two chimpanzees in this act here. Actually.
Now that is an act.
Boy, that is something. That is really rare.
But come on now, what sort of tricks do they do?
They do a basic trick, you know, where the chicken puts her head in the chimpanzee's open mouth and the dog does a backflip. Okay, you want to see it? Here it is.
So
on the verge of speech, isn't he?
So let me get this straight. This is what you're going to do.
You know, after you've spent all these years writing a new show every week, it's just a luxury to be able to do one small trick over and over and over. So
yeah, I guess so. Yeah,
that's what I'm going to do.
I guess so.
Okay, so, last show, huh?
That's right, Sue.
Okay, so how does it feel?
You know, that's what Bob asked me just the other day.
Wait, you talked to Bob?
Well, Bob talked to me, actually.
How does it feel to be at the end, going round the bend, on your final descent toward the ground, my friend, like an ice cream cone? Or a foreclosed loan in the Twilight Zone. Quite a milestone.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you. I appreciate the gesture. So tell me, Bob Dylan, are you planning to retire yourself?
Not me, babe. Okay, no, it's not me, babe. Who's going to retire, babe.
Okay, so really, how does it feel?
How does it feel? It feels like something ends and something else is going to happen. That's simple.
But that's all?
Well, that's enough, you know.
Well, excuse me, but I'll tell you this. Some of us are going to miss this show a heck of a lot because, well, ever since I died, this is the only show where I get to say what I think. You know, you have been awfully good to us ghosts.
Well, thank you, Mr. President.
Well, that goes for me too, Pilgrim. Except for my occasional guest appearances on your show, my acting career is pretty much over.
Well.
Excuse me, but you've kept me alive, too. I was a big star in this town, and you know, then you die, and you're a big nobody, and the people stand up there, and they do a Jimmy Stewart impression, and the kids, they look at each other and say, who the heck is that?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you this. The kids all know who I am because I made a great movie, and you, Stewart, you wasted your time on those lousy westerns. They keep playing my movie again and again, Sam. You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. But classics never die. No, they don't. They still watch Casablanca. Yes, sir. As time goes by.
Thank you, sir.
That goes for me on the double, too. I was a big star in the Three Tenors, and then Pavarotti became Patui. Except here on your show, l'ottone mobile, qual puma vento, muta d'incento e di pensiero, sempre un abile, leggero viso, in pianto riso, e menzognero.
Ah, lovely, lovely, Mr. Pavarotti.
So, your last show, huh?
Life is a show. Come on, it's Fred.
So you're not afraid that life after broadcasting is going to be boring? No?
In St. Paul, Minnesota? Are you kidding? Come on, Fred, listen. Back when I got my FCC radio operator's license, you had to know Morse code. And when you know Morse code, You become privy to a world of crisis. Yes, that's a signal, if I'm not mistaken, from a mine shaft, an abandoned mine shaft, where a young man named Timmy has fallen in. So I'm going to start up the chopper here, the Sikorsky chopper. Come on, Shep, come on. There you go. All right. We're going to head off to rescue that darn kid who fell down that abandoned mine shaft there. Okay. 96 heading 180 east northeast there. Okay, we're making our descent here. All right. Okay, we're going to set off a signal rocket, let the kid know. There you go. Very nice. All right, in we go, Shep. In we go. Uh-oh. Look up there. Look up there in the sky. It's a meteoroid, and it's heading straight for Earth. We've got about 2 minutes before it strikes the Earth, and goodness knows what's going to happen then. We've got to notify that submarine that's in Lake Superior. Okay, you got our signal there. He's on it. Submarine is surfacing there, preparing to fire. Oh, no. Oh, no. A mutant dolphin. One of those evil mutant dolphins is surfacing there. Yeah. In Lake Superior and heading for that submarine. Crazed dolphin. You got to set the chopper down here on this the mine shaft head here. And set her down to set up a signal rocket there to warn the submarine. There we go. All right. Now we're going to have to shoot that dolphin with a hypodermic needle. No pain involved, folks. There you go. Okay, we're going to lower the winch now down into the mine shaft there for Timmy to grab hold of that. Timmy, you down there?
Yeah, I got it.
All right, grab hold of it. We're going to have to pull you up fast because there are a lot of copperheads there in that mine shaft. Look out. Big snakes there. Pull them up there. Okay, there you go. There you go. And now the submarine is shooting the two forward tube rockets. The two missiles going out there, and they hit the meteorite. There we go. And the world is saved. All right. You okay there, Timmy? You okay?
You saved my life, mister.
You bet I did, kid. And it's good that I retired from radio in time to do it, kid. You would have been a goner.
Adventures in Retirement. Stories of people in the twilight years doing things they never dreamed were possible. Join us next week when we hear Mr. Weiler say,
"You know, I used to be afraid of heights, but here I am at the top of this 200-foot tower, about to dive into that wet sponge in the tank below. 3, 2. What's this? Oh, my gosh, it's that raven. It's that darned raven. Why won't he leave me alone?
Nevermore. Nevermore.
That's our show for tonight from the Hollywood Bowl here in Hollywood. Our producer, technical director, is Sam Hudson. Our director, Dan Rolls. The show was written by Sarah Bellum. Our broadcast transmission engineers, Thomas Scheutzker and Noah Smith. Our stage managers, Albert Wester, Ken Evans, and Tom Campbell. Our lighting designer, Janice Kaiser. And our house sound engineer out in the house is Todd Behrens. Our music librarians, Catherine Schlesher and Maddie Calhoun, Kate Gornick and Jennifer Howe. Managing director is Kate Gustafson. Our marketing director is David O'Neill. Our project director is Mr. Tony Judge. Our script supervisor, Ella Smith, and our researchers, Holly Harden, Olivia Pellin. Our web and video guy is Ben Miller. Our tour wrangler is Deborah Beck and Dina Rigo. Thanks to all of our wonderful listeners here on KPCC-FM. Our music director here at the piano is Mr. Richard Dworsky. Mr. Chris Sebold playing guitar tonight. Mr. Richard Crean playing the mandolin and the fiddle. Mr. Larry Cohut back here on the bass, and Mr. Bernard Dressel playing the drums. Thank you, Mr. Tim Russell, Sue Scott, and Fred Newman doing everything that he does out there. And thanks to you once again, Christine DiGiulinardo, Thank you, Sarah Jarosz. Thank you, Sarah Watkins. Thank you, Eva O'Donovan. And thank you, Heather Massey. So good to be here with you. And thank you, everybody. Now it's been something seeing you again. In this time we've had to spend, you've been so good to be around. I thank you for that special thrill. Keeps me going on until the next time I'm in town.
Though I won't be back here for a while, I hear your laughter, see your smile. I'll remember what went down. I can't tell you how or when, but I'll be seeing you again the next time I'm in town.
Now the faces and the places ring,
cross the bridge of time and change. Once again I'm homeward bound. There's one thing I promise you, and that's another rendezvous the next time I'm in town.
Thank you, everybody. Good night.
American Public Media.
I went into radio and started up a show long years ago. Lasted 40-something years, and why it didn't end, I'll never know. Remember that show with Chet Atkins on the bill in Nashville, Tennessee, with the brothers Don and Phil. And Emmylou was there, Ricky Skaggs and Vince Gill. I can hear them if I stand real still. Rod Cooter and Gene Redpath, the list goes on and on. The Chatterbox Cafe, the Lutherans of Lake Wobegon. Remember Arlo Guthrie, Doc Watson played guitar, and Dusty and Lefty and Guy Noir. All the stories we could tell, I wouldn't kid someone I know so well. Someday we'll be sitting at a bar in some hotel, recalling the stories we could tell. I was lucky to have the employment, my dears, go on, for 42 years. And I never got fired, because I am the boss, and I had no regrets because of memory loss. It was heard by children with terrible impatience, forced to listen by their relations. Those children grew up and achieved independence, and they forced the show on their descendants. All the stories we could tell, and I wouldn't kid someone I know so well. Someday we'll be sitting at a bar in some hotel, recalling the stories we could tell. Oh, Sarah and Sarah, Ether, Heather, Prudence, Christine, I got to sing duets with, just like in a dream. Standing shoulder to shoulder at a microphone, smelling the flowers of her cologne. I look back at all that history, people I met who said, "You've been a friend to me." And they recall a story I told years ago, and what it meant to them I'll never know. And suddenly today becomes the past. For decades and it went by so fast. And others will come and stand here in my place, and I never will forget those Saturdays. I never will forget those Saturdays. Oh, I never will forget those Saturdays. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Heather Massey. This is a song that Mr. Greg Brown wrote many, 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 many years ago, back in the early days of our show, about a little town in Iowa called Early. I've loved this song now for 40 years. Early one morning, I walked out alone. I looked down the street, no one was around. The sun was just coming up over my home on Hickory Street in a little farm town.
Ooh-wee, ain't the morning light pretty when the dew is still heavy, so bright and early. My home on the range, it's a one-horse town, and it's all right with me. Oh, the plow broke the prairie, and the prairie gave plenty. The little towns blossomed, soon there were many, scattered like fireflies across the dark night. And one was called Early, and they sure named it right. Ooh-wee, ain't the morning light pretty when the dew is still heavy, so bright and early. My home on the range, it's a one-horse town, and it's all right with me. Oh. The fine colors cut down on the yields, but the rain has returned to wash away our tears. It's the fullest green summer that we've seen in years. Ooh-wee, ain't the morning light pretty when the dew is still heavy, so bright and to one horse town, and it's all right with me.
My life, it don't count for nothing. When I look at this world, a
I feel so small. My life, it's only a season, a passing November that no one will recall. But I gave joy to my mother, and I made my lover smile. I can give comfort to my friends when they're hurting. I can make it seem better for a while. My life, it's most the way traveled. Still I have not found my way out of this night. My life, it's tangled in wishes and so many things that just never turned out right. But I gave joy to my mother, and I made my lover smile. I can give comfort to my friends when they're hurting. I can make it seem better. I can make it seem better. I can make it seem better for a while. Oh, this is a song that we did years and years ago. This is an old hymn tune, only remembered by what we have done. So good to sing with all of you young people here. Thank you so much, Heather Massey, for joining us, and Christine DiGilinardo. Thank you so much, Sarah Jarosz. Thank you, Sarah Watkins. Thank you, Aoife O'Donovan. Fading away like the stars of the morning, losing their light in the glorious sun. Thus shall we pass from this earth and its toiling, only remembered for what we have done.
Only remember, only remember, only remember for what we have done.
Thus shall we pass from this earth and its toiling, only remember for what we have done. Shall we be missed by the ones who shall follow, reaping the harvest in fields we have sown? No, we shall pass from our labors in silence, only remembered for what we have done.
Only remember, only remember, only remember for what we have done.
Thus would we pass from this earth and its toiling,
only remember for what we have done.
Only the truth that in life we have spoken, only the seed that in life we have sown, these shall pass onward when we are forgotten, only remembered for what we have done.
Only remember, only remember, only remember for what we have done.
These shall pass onward when we are forgotten,
only remembered for what
we have done. Who'll sing the anthem and who'll tell the story? Will the line hold? Will it shatter and run? Shall we at last be united in glory? Only remembered for what we have done.
Only remember, only remember, only remember for what we have done.
Shall we at last be united in glory?
Only remember for what we have done. Only remember for what we have done.
Irene, good night. Irene, good night. Good night, Irene. Good night, Irene. I'll see trails to until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then. Who cares about the clouds when we're together? Just sing a song and bring the sunny weather. Happy trails to you till we meet again. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry, carry me home. Swing, swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. I looked over Jordan, and what did I see?
Thank you.
they